Daisy's motive for killing her son Rhodes remains a mystery. In the case of her first two husbands, the motive seemed to be financial gain. Rhodes seems to have been under the impression that he would come into an inheritance at age 21. He might have started to strain his mother and start making demands she couldn't fulfill, according to one theory. The other theory is that Daisy had grown to hate him because, despite her lifetime of pampering, he never treated her with respect. Today's story is about Daisy de Melker. Daisy was born in Seven Fountains in what was then the Cape Colony. She moved to Zimbabwe when she was 12 years old. She returned to Cape Town in 1903, but soon moved to KZN. While on vacation in Rhodesia, Daisy fell in love with Bert Fuller, a young man employed by Broken Hill's Native Affairs Department. They had set October 1907 as the date for their wedding. On the day of their wedding, Fuller, who had gotten Blackwater fever, passed away with Daisy by his side. Fuller left his fiancée £100 in his will. Daisy married plumber William Alfred Cowell in Johannesburg in March 1909, almost 18 months after Fuller had passed away. She was 22 and he was 36. The couple had five kids, but four of them passed away. The first two were twins who passed away in infancy. The third died of a liver abscess. The fourth, who had convulsions and intestinal issues, passed away at the age of 15 months. Their only surviving child, Rhodes Cecil, was born in June 1911. Early on the morning of the 11th of January 1923, William Cowell became ill soon after taking Epsom salts prepared by his wife. The first doctor who attended Cowell did not consider his condition serious and prescribed a bromide mixture. Cowell's condition, however, immediately deteriorated. Shortly after the doctor left, he started to become worse. Daisy requested assistance from the neighbors and made a second doctor appointment. When the second doctor arrived, Cowell was in excruciating pain. He foamed at the mouth, went blue in the face, and screamed in agony if anyone touched him until he died. When the second doctor was given these symptoms and suspected strychnine poisoning, he refused to sign the death certificate. The post-mortem was then performed by Dr. Fergus, the acting district surgeon. The cause of death was certified to be chronic nephritis and cerebral hemorrhage. Daisy received £1,795 as the sole beneficiary of her husband's will. On January 11, 1926, 36-year-old Daisy wed another plumber, Robert Sproat, who was 10 years older than Daisy. In October 1927, Robert experienced excruciating pain and excruciating muscle spasms, the same symptoms as Cal. Following a brief time of recovery, Robert had another attack after having beer with his wife and stepson Rhodes. He died on November 6, 1927. The attending physician, Dr. Malinick, certified that cerebral hemorrhage and arteriosclerosis were the causes of death. No autopsy was performed. Following Robert's death, his widow inherited over £4,000, plus a further £560 paid by his pension fund. On the 21st of January, 1931, Daisy married for the third time. Her husband was a widower, Sidney Clarence de Melker. Like her two previous husbands, he was a plumber. Daisy had made the trip to Terfontein in late February 1932 from Germiston on the East Rand to buy arsenic from a pharmacy. She stated that she needed the poison to kill a sick cat and went by her old name, Sproat. Less than a week later, on the 2nd of March 1932, Rhodes, aged 20, fell ill at work after drinking coffee from a thermos flask his mother had prepared for him. James Webster, a co-worker, also experienced terrible sickness. Webster, who had had very little of the coffee, made a full recovery in a few days, but Rhodes passed away on March 5th at noon at home. After an autopsy, cerebral malaria was identified as the cause of death. The following day, Rhodes was laid to rest in New Brixton Cemetery. On April 1st, de Melker was given £100 from Rhodes' life insurance policy. By this time, William Sproat, Daisy's former brother-in-law, had informed the authorities of his suspicions regarding his brother Robert's passing. The police were given permission by a court order to exhume the bodies of Robert, Cowell, and Rhodes on April 15, 1932. Rhodes' remains were found to be in an unusually good state of preservation, which is characteristic of the presence of arsenic in large quantities. The viscera, backbone, and hair all had signs of arsenic, according to a state forensic pathologist. The vertebrae of Cowell and Robert Sproat both had residues of strychnine, despite the fact that their bodies were mostly decomposed. Additionally, the men's bones had a pinkish taint that suggested they had consumed pink strychnine, which was popular at the time. Traces of arsenic were also found in the hair and fingernails of James Webster, Rhodes' surviving colleague. 1 week later, de Melker was arrested and charged with the murders of all three men. Public interest in the case grew, and newspapers gave the story a great deal of coverage. Mr. Abraham Spilkin, the Terfontein chemist from whom she had purchased the arsenic that killed her son, contacted authorities after recognizing de Melker from a newspaper photograph as Mrs. D.L. Sproat, who had signed the poisons register. The de Melker trial lasted 30 days. 60 witnesses were called for the Crown and less than half this number for the defense. To present the forensic evidence, the Crown employed the services of Dr. J.M. Watt, an expert toxicologist and professor of pharmacology at Witwatersrand University. In summing up, before giving his verdict, the judge pointed out that the Crown had been unable to prove conclusively that Cowell and Sproat had died of strychnine poisoning. "It does not convince me, nor does it convict the accused," he said. On the third count, however, he had come to the inescapable conclusion that de Melker had murdered her son. This was evident because Rhodes Cowell had died of arsenic poisoning. The coffee flask held traces of arsenic. The defense of suicide was untenable. When the judge finally turned to sentence de Melker, her face turned pale, but she maintained her innocence. De Melker was sentenced to death by hanging. The sentence was carried out at Pretoria Central Prison on the morning of December 30, 1932. Daisy's motive for killing her son Rhodes remains a mystery. In the case of her first two husbands, the motive seemed to be financial gain. Rhodes seems to have been under the impression that he would come into an inheritance at age 21. He might have started to strain his mother and start making demands she couldn't fulfill. According to one theory, the other theory is that Daisy had grown to hate him because, despite her lifetime of pampering, he never treated her with respect.